Welcome back to the ZERT Coffee and Chaos podcast, the show where we will talk about anything and everything relating to what it means to be a survivalist and a prepared individual in today's society. I'm your host, Chris Bartigon, ZP002, for those of you in the know, and my co-host, Jamie Franks. Jamie? X739 Delta. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here because I've been on life support since our last recording, like pretty much right after we recorded the last episode. Like I got hit with like a hammer with this cold. That's why I sound like I do right now and look like I do right now. Yeah. As I like to say, for the last week, I've felt like I got eaten by a coyote and shit off a cliff. So I'm glad to be back upright and coherent. And I've actually not taken any cold medicine today to see how I feel it at my baseline. So I think I'm finally at the point where I'm getting over it, but I'm much better. Happy to be here. What are we, what's the count? 5 more days until Hans falls off of Nakatomi. Yep. And
talk. 5 more days until the social media posts about the disturbance at the Nakatomi Plaza pop up, which are always great to see. Gunshots heard at Nakatomi Plaza. Well, man, that is that's never fun. Getting that sickness, that ick. It's never a good time. Fortunately, we have remained somewhat upright this year with no issues. Yep. And hopefully we are going to knock on wood that we will make it through the rest of this year without any kind of situation happening. Yeah, so
it is never a good time. And I mean, that's also not to beat a dead horse. I was about to say beat a dead drum, but there is never a good time to get sick. I mean, I'm glad I got it kind of, if I was going to get it, got it when I did. So I should be over it by Christmas, by the time Santa comes down the chimney. But that is also something to factor into your survival plan a little bit. Like, you know, what are you going to do if you get sick? You know, or do you have cold medicine and Sudafed and Benadryl and that kind of stuff in your go bag? Because it's never fun, especially when you're on your own. I mean, survival and prepping and all that kind of stuff is hard enough as is, but it's even harder when you know feel like a hammered turd because you're sick. I was just gonna say one thing I've noticed since COVID, because everybody was like locked down and isolated for so long, like the first couple of like just colds that I had after COVID like hit me like a hammer, and then I've noticed since then, like the colds kind of hit me, I think, harder than they used to, but I get over them quicker. So there's something weird going on with just regular seasonal colds post-COVID. Yeah.
So you just brought up a good point. I just go back to that. It was a scene in a movie, and we reference them a lot, but it was a scene in 13 Hours where they were heading to the annex. And I remember they were all rolling out as QRF, and John Krasinski's character is like, Oh no, I don't have my contact. We can't go. And like, you know, the guy, I mean, it was a joke and whatnot, but you know,
now he was serious. It was like a little comic relief, but he was serious.
Well,
but
I mean, he might've been serious, but at the end of the day, it's figure that shit out because we're going, we're not turning around. You know, if you're in a survival situation and you have got a cough, buck up. There is no time to kind of lay down and get some rest. I mean, getting rest is important. Obviously we're not there. I'm glad you were able to hopefully get some rest and glad to hear that you are on the mend.
Last weekend, I barely got off of my couch. Like that. I was glued to my couch for two and a half days.
There are definitely times for that as well. And so this week's episode is kind of leave the world behind or be prepared to live in it, part two. And that was what the last week's episode was titled, leave the world behind or be prepared to live in it. And I know that when we left last week's episode, we were trying not to give spoilers. Guys, if you haven't seen it by now, then, you know, spoilers are ahead, and we are going to dive into some of the situations in the movie and kind of correlate them to real life situations. But obviously that requires us to talk about some details in the movie. I did watch it again last night, and I will say that I had the notebook out, and this time I actually took notes because there were some things that I wanted to jot down, specifically the conversation that she had, that Julie Roberts' character has at the beginning. I think that it sets the tone, and there's some important things right off the bat. And she's talking about looking out the window and seeing the people getting out there and doing what they can to make the world better. And then she's like, but then I realized what the world really is. And I fucking hate people. And there's a lot to kind of unwrap there. You know, people will send you pictures of a beautiful sunset or a sunrise, and it's cannon fodder for the most part, right? I mean, what's happening across the country right now, based off what's happening overseas, is just disgusting. And that brief moment of beauty that's noticed or whatnot at the end of the day, it's designed or it's there to distract you from what is really happening. And I think that was her point. Like, yeah, okay, they're out there trying to better themselves, better the world, but the world is just a shit show. I mean, for the
lack of better terms. She ties it all together really nicely. She's speaking to, I've seen the movie three times now, and I can't recall character names all that well. But
Clay,
the teenage girl.
Oh, the daughter. Yes,
yeah.
Rose.
Yeah, okay. When they're in the little shack towards the end of the movie, she kind of ties it all together and kind of says, you know, it's kind of the narcissism of Americans. She doesn't phrase it that way, but she talks about how, you know, in our own minds or in a lot of people's minds, you think you're changing the world because you're using a paper straw instead of a plastic straw. But, you know, right. and she goes a lot deeper than that. And everything she says, I actually agree with as well. And it just earlier this week, I saw a article because all this, you know, climate change stuff, you know, constantly comes back around.
Right.
And over the last, I think I saw something that says like since 2013, the United States has reduced our carbon emissions by like 10% or something like that. But the rest of the world, like India and China and Russia, like they have gone up like 500%. So, you know, at the end of the day, it's kind of what you're saying and kind of what Julia Roberts' character is going after is we're, and they say it in The Matrix too, you know, humans are a parasite on the planet, and our narcissism of thinking we're using a paper straw is not even a drop of bucket or a spit in the ocean as compared to the negative that's being done by the rest of the world. You know, Leonardo DiCaprio driving his Prius is not going to save the world. And the chickens are going to come home to roost at some point, whether it's in our lifetime or not, but.
Right. And, you know, and her character does go from one end of the spectrum of me enjoying what she's talking about to the other end where she's just like, okay, you know, enough. But I noticed that. And again, there was, it just made me realize like, okay, great. I mean, I'm guilty myself. I'll snap a picture of something that I think is beautiful or is a wild looking image. And then you realize, yeah, but if you look a little bit closer, there's probably trash all over the ground right underneath this. And that's one of the scenes that they show you. Okay, so they get to this beautiful house. Great, whatnot. Then they go to the beach, right? One of the things that so rewatching this movie, what I noticed is the cinematography in it is pretty amazing, and it's awesome the way that they do things.
Very calculated as well.
It is very calculated.
Everything is very deliberate.
Right. So when they get, and we'll get to that in a second. So one of the things I noticed as soon as they came in the front door of the house, there was a giant window to the right and to the left of the front door. Okay. And we talked about the front door opening, but, when they get to the beach, right, they show up, there's this beautiful beach. They show this ocean, beautiful beach. That tanker is off in the distance, but this beautiful beach. And then the first close-up shot that they get to is all of the trash on the beach. Did you notice that?
Yeah.
Like, you know, again, it goes back. I don't know if they're doing it subliminally, but they are, they're just reinforcing kind of what she said. To me anyway, that, and this is all my take on it. So, you know, I know that I would love to hear people, other people's take, and I'm sure Jamie would enjoy that as well. So if you are
for sure
listening to part two of this, and if you listened to part one, went and watched the movie and now part two, I would love to hear some feedback. Head down into the comments here. And, as always, this episode is being streamed on YouTube. So if you are listening to this on Spotify or Apple Podcasts, head over to the YouTube channel and like and subscribe and hit the bell so you get notified when we do put these episodes up. As always, episodes are published on every on a Thursday of every single week. So just that little disclaimer in there. And what stuck out to me again was the, she noticed some, she made some comment about the Wi-Fi password, and she stated what kind of Wi-Fi it was. And, and she had said something about he was probably in some kind of cybersecurity thing, which I thought was awkward at first. But some things to note: when they first get there, the TV is working.
Yeah.
I don't know that the Wi-Fi is, because the daughter never goes back to watch Friends. They go to the pool and they go outside and play.
And he's watching a baseball game.
He is watching a baseball game.
So that could just be like television antenna, not necessarily Wi-Fi or satellite or anything like that. Yeah.
True. Yeah. Could be just local cable. It's obviously very clear in the movie that it is New York City and that it is Long Island. And then that whole thing was obviously about the house, right? Then they go to the beach. It is what it is on the beach, right? They watch the tanker roll in, and there's been some, have you watched any of the, like the explainers or the videos, have you seen anybody talking about it?
So I kind of started to go down that route a little bit, but the stuff I kept seeing was like, you know, cause I'm sure we'll get to it, but there's a scene where all the Teslas are like driving themselves away from the dealerships and on their little Tesla autopilot mode, and they're all crashing. And like, so I kept seeing stuff like, oh, well, that wouldn't really happen because a Tesla would need 230 hours of direct sunlight to be able to fully charge, to be able to blah, blah, blah. Like, it was just people like poking holes in all the technological kind of cybersecurity tech stuff. Like, oh, satellites don't work that way, and this doesn't do that. And so I just, it seemed like a rabbit hole to nowhere. And so I looked at a couple things, and that's not how I wanted to break this movie down. So I didn't want to be like, well, that would never happen. That guy shot 14 bullets out of the gun. Like I didn't want this to be that. So
exactly. So, but one of the things I noticed is, you know, the name of the tanker, and whether they do it, it's White Lion, right?
White Lion,
and then, and then people were going on and they were searching White Lion songs, and there's one called, I don't know, When the Children Sleep or something like that. And again, When the Children Cry, there it is. And there's some lyrics in there that they're like, okay. And the lyrics kind of sync up to some of the stuff happening in the movie. It is what it is. But as they're leaving the beach, they talk to the police officer. And again, we stated this last week, the police officer tells them that there was some reports of this happening. The drive home is what just blows my mind. And this was going back to what you were saying. They're just driving. At one point, they're trying to find more information about it. And then the next minute, she's like, oh, look, a Starbucks. What the hell?
But I mean, do you agree with me, though, that like, I think that's kind of authentic. I mean, my opinion of the regular average American has kind of dipped so low that I believe that to be pretty authentic. Do you agree?
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, yeah, to an extent, I think that's what it is. It's people just go back into their happy place.
They talk about it in, I think I said this last week, I'm not sure, but they talk about it in Fight Club, like how like most people will go so far out of their way to avoid confrontation that it's ridiculous. And there's another movie that I love. I'm a big horror movie guy. I'm a big movie guy in general, but I like horror movies. There's a movie that came out in 2017, I think. It's called The Invitation. That movie is so freaking good. But it's another one of these movies that I think the people in the movie, and when they're in this situation and things start going south, I believe their reactions to be 100% authentic to what the real life versions of those characters would actually do and actually say. And people just go so far out of their way to be willfully, blissfully ignorant and bury their head in the sand and pretend like bad things aren't happening until they literally get hit in the face with it. Like,
right.
And that's what we saw in this movie. And that's what you see in that movie, The Invitation. I highly recommend. And
yeah.
And you know how, like, just from like a movie making standpoint, you know, some movies like follow a template, you know, there's the template of a tragedy and the template of a comedy. And, you know, and last week I made the analogy that, in a lot of ways, this movie reminded me of the Blair Witch Project, and watching this movie two more times. So, and I really like how like Point Break and the first Fast and Furious movie are basically the exact same movie. It's just one has surfboards and one has race cars. Like, this movie is very similar in plot progression, like to the Blair Witch Project. And it's a different subject matter, but it follows the same kind of plot line, I think. But rewatching this movie, everything I talked about last week that I said bugged me, like now watching it twice more, all of those things like bugged me even more, but kind of like what you said, a lot more detail jumped out of me. And some of the things I don't know what to make of it. You and I discussed via text.
Right. Right. Yeah, and I want to circle back to that when we get to kind of to the end of this, because I think there's a lot to kind of unpack with that. So after they get back from the beach is when they realize the Wi-Fi is not working. The TV is out. The daughter notices the deer. So those three things happen. But they... And Julie Roberts' character, she's like, I'm trying to find stuff about the tanker. But again, internet's out, TV's out. And then it's, okay, well, I'm just going to make dinner. Are you going to help? So making dinner, and they're outside on the patio eating dinner, and the son's putting broccoli in the young girl's thing. And everybody's just kind of happy-go-lucky at that point. And the kids go to sleep.
Two things around this point in the movie that jumped out at me watching this again is when they first figure out that the Wi-Fi and the TV and all that stuff is not working. And I mentioned last week, and I caged it in reference to how the kids are completely not self-sufficient and not independent young humans. But the girl asks the dad, can he fix the TV? Can he reboot it? Can he go up on the roof or something? And Julia Roberts says, no, nobody's going on the roof. And it actually, like, that jumped out at me watching it again, because at that point in the situation, going up on the roof would have been a perfect idea. Like, that would have been one of the best ideas they could have done, would be to go up on the roof and just observe and look at what's going on around them and listen and look and see. And, you know,
but hold on. I just want to check the timeline here. I don't think that was until the next day, because the next morning the daughter wakes up sitting on Julia Roberts saying, we have two problems. One, the TV is completely out. And problem number two is that she can't watch thing. And then that's when they come downstairs and notice that the TV went from blue to snow.
To snow.
Right. So that first day after they get back, Yeah, after they get back from the beach, it's 11:15 p.m. when they're playing Jenga, drinking, and she notices a knock at the door. And the reason I know that it's 11:15 p.m. is because first she notices the, she's like, hey, did you hear that? And he's just oblivious, talking about doing something for work. And then she says again, and then they cut to a picture of the clock. Like there was like either a wall clock or there was a grandfather clock, but it was 11:15 p.m. Mm-hmm. So I noted that time. Again, they walk to the door. At some point he's like, okay, maybe just get your cell phone. Because it, you know, like, all right, it's 11:15. He realizes something's a little wonky, grabs this decorative thing. But then instead of looking at the door, the window that he had to pass to get to the door, just opens it. And then that whole exchange happens. And after the first knock, GH does communicate through the door. So there is communication.
Yep. I noticed that too. Yep.
And so that's one of the points that I like about this movie is they're like, oh God, maybe this is bad. Then they kind of set your mind at ease. And then they pull that right back. So,
well, they walk the balance beam between making you think that GH is maybe a villain, but maybe not. But for their part on that, and we talked about this last week, but watching it again, I think everything that Clay, Ethan Hawke's character, I think everything he did was basically wrong. And I think in terms of a stranger presenting yourself at somebody's front door in the middle of the night, everything that GH did was pretty spot on. But they kind of play off of the kind of normal distrust that we have for each other as humans now that you need to have.
And it goes back to Julia Roberts' opening statement about, you know, I know what I see the world for what it is or whatever. And that's why she hates people. So they get in the house and then obviously there's some back and forth communication. I'm sure the second time you notice the gun that he reaches over. So, you know, he starts going through and fumbling with the keys. So again, he's like, oh, they set you up. They say, he's got the keys. So he's good. Then it's, oh no, the keys aren't working. And then it's, oh, I should have labeled these keys.
Yeah. My wife said I should have labeled these.
Right. Yeah. And then obviously he looks at the gun, doesn't grabs the thing of cash. All great. And again, there's a lot of things that are kind of, whether they're glossed over, whether they're talked about for a reason about this, you know, they're at the symphony or the, you know, they're at the, okay. I don't know why they threw that in there, but you know, there's some mistrust based off of the communication going back and forth between GH and Julia Roberts. They step out. Right. And then they do Julie Roberts and Ethan Hawke's character. They step out to discuss this. And then they come back and he's like, I'm going to make a drink. And what I specifically noticed when he came back, he asked him, do you want this drink? And he was like, well, I haven't touched this one yet. So here you go. Right. So, he sits down and then I think either Ethan Hawke's character or GH says, do you want one? And the first thing that Julius Roberts says is, well, what's in it? Mm-hmm. And before he can answer, Clay's like, this is so good. Like, you know, just with this dorky smile and giggle. And I'm just like, dude. And then they move right past it. Like it never, like the drink thing obviously doesn't come back up.
But I wrote this down in my notes because this is actually something that's been bothering me, like just kind of in my life the last, I don't know, the last year, year and a half or something. Because I started to notice, because I feel like it has had an impact on my personal life as well. There's this like common thread now that you see it everywhere. You see it in TV shows. You see it in car commercials. The other night I went to the movies with my daughter and there was like a Capital One commercial at the beginning of the movie. And it's in this Capital One commercial where like men, like husbands, are being portrayed all over like I was about to say social media, but like just it's everywhere. Like men are just being portrayed as like bumbling buffoons. Like in the Capital One commercial, it's like the wife is like, my husband would be lost if it wasn't for me. And he's like, oh, yep, I don't know how to do these numbers. That's a good thing my wife told me to do the Capital One app. And you see like in car commercials, like men are just these bumbling idiots that can't figure out how to get the thing into the back of the Subaru or whatever. Like, and it's kind of, like I said, I feel like it's actually had a little bit of impact on my personal life as a single dude that's out in the dating world. Like I kind of think women are being brainwashed with this idea that like men are these like bumbling complete idiots and like they're like men are no or very rarely are men portrayed as masculine. Right. Men are portrayed as like these clueless idiots that would be lost if it wasn't for their wives. And like right. I wrote
now, and then, now we probably have some women that are listening to this going, well, yeah, I mean, some of you are. And listen, I'm not going to say that there's probably not some of them that are not. But, you know, for the most part, I mean, that's not it. You're right. It's stereotypical.
It has become stereotypical that they kind of like throw it in your face, like in the movie to me over and over again in the movie, like the next morning when they wake up, Julia Roberts is kind of trying to shake him out of his ignorant stupor and like, oh, hey, right. Look, I need you to do something. Like we need to figure this out. And he's like, you know what?
Yeah.
I'm going to do so. I'm going to fix this for us.
Yeah.
I'm going to go buy a newspaper. Like that's his answer. Like his answer exactly. When he finally decides to man up is I'm going to go buy a newspaper. Like it reinforces that new negative stereotype that's fallen on men.
Because she's still upset in his report. So yeah. But before we do that, the last thing that happens in this part one is the TV goes from the blue screen of death, right? Letting everybody know that it's network emergency network. The blue screen with the thing you get a brief glimpse of a news report from CNN, which again, I'm like, okay, why did they choose it? But it's funny. They show you CNN, the New York Times, but there's no Fox News in it. So anyway, CNN, and it says that CNN's reporting a cyber attack across the country. And they show you a picture of the United States with hotspots of mm-hmm. big or high threat to medium or no threat. One of the Easter eggs in that little thing is a QR code. Was not able to get it. I was not able to scan it, but the QR code is somewhere over Pennsylvania, Ohio. And it's all about an amusement park where a lot of things went kind of sideways, not Action Park, which that's its own story. But I tried to pause it and scan the QR code. I could not, but I know that it's out there on the internet. And that's kind of the last thing. You get that little brief glimpse and then the TV goes to snow.
I was just going to jump in and quickly say, like, if anybody, if you either haven't watched it yet or you've stupidly only watched it once and not three times, there's several places in the movie, and it's like it's a cool thing that this is a Netflix release. Like there's several places where if you can pause it just right, there's like some valuable stuff that can be found by like things like that they just kind of glass over. If you pause it and really look at it, there's some really you can glean some good Easter or not Easter egg, but so like more depth to what's going on.
Yeah. So then the next day is when obviously they all wake up in the house. Now, Julie Roberts and Ethan Hawke's kids still have no idea about the people in the house. And there is the whole, the TV is out, fix my stuff. I'm going to go to the store to get the newspaper. So the husband leaves the wife and the kids in this house with people that they don't 100% trust.
She says nobody goes on the roof when going on the roof.
Oh, yeah.
And that's a great idea.
Exactly. That's when she says, right. That's when that whole thing happens about rabbit ears. And I got to say that we've talked about it in the past. They were triggers to your survival plan. Right now, there's, in my mind, and I'd love to hear some feedback, there's two triggers that are clearly activated. Cell phones are down. There's no communication, right? Because what I noticed is they didn't try and call anybody. So do they, well, nobody. I'm sorry. When GH shows up at 11:15, they say we would have called, but cell phones aren't working. So the last time they showed anybody using their cell phone in an actual phone scenario is her on the phone with somebody on the drive to the house, right?
In the scene where they first come in the middle of the night, 11:15 p.m., and they come in and he accesses the cabinet and all that stuff, and there is a quick little part where she looks at her phone and goes, "Oh yeah, I don't have service." And so, like, again, like, there's a lot of these things in movies that are used as like a vehicle, or, you know, to get to the next plot point. And, you know, back in the old days, that it would have been the person picking up the phone and going on the little thing, like,
right?
But we don't do that anymore because nobody has house phones anymore. Now, every single time you pick up your cell phone, whether you do it consciously or subliminally, you look at your signal and you see, like, oh, I only have one bar or two bars or five bars, or, oh, I'm connected to 5G, or now it's on my iPhone. It's, if I don't have service, it says SOS, right? So now I think people just subconsciously do that. So they quickly made reference to it in that one scene where she goes, "Oh yeah, I don't have service." And so I think that's pretty realistic in today's day and age where, I mean, you're not going to try to call somebody if you look at your phone and see that you don't have service because you know it's not going to work.
Right. But. So the next morning, the first thing that we get introduced to is alerts on the phone, the news from alerts, CNN, yeah. News Time, that a cyber attack has happened. It's CNN, New York Times, and then the last one, I believe, is either New York Times, but there is some gibberish, which I think the interwebs has classified as it was Russian. So it's funny that.
Yeah, okay.
Again, that's what the interwebs is talking about. But basically, it says East Coast power failure.
Mm-hmm.
And then she goes to show him the phone, and it's not there. And I want to.
Come on.
Well, right. I mean, it just, that doesn't, like, I can't get notifications off my phone without doing like five steps. So
exactly.
But I want to, but I think that I'm going to lump that in the basket of what we're going to talk about at the end. Some of those subtle things that you and I were texting about last night. So the daughter notices the deer. Ethan Hawke's husband goes out to go buy a newspaper to solve the world's problems, which, you know, he's out there just acting normal. GH's character goes to go to the neighbors, and the kids are there with the wife and the daughter. But going back to what I was saying before we got to this, in my mind, two triggers are activated, and they're pretty well connected to each other, right? You have zero phone lines and you have no access to information, meaning the internet is out.
And I think, just quickly, I think it's a valid reminder that you don't have to go from zero to bug out. You don't have to go to zero to emergency plan. Like, there needs to be, and there should be, several intermediate steps in there. Like, I described them last week as like little touch points that you put in your plan. But, and like, one of those things being somebody showed up at the door unexpectedly. They have this story about a blackout and comms being down and all this other stuff. So your answer to that should not be everybody all go to sleep at once. Like, you know, one of those little touch points or one of those intermediate steps between zero and bug out or whatever, whatever your plan is okay, well, let's have somebody, let's sleep in shifts and have somebody stay up and stand watch and all that.
Yeah. But there's a difference between blackout and internet out, phone out, right? Yeah. A blackout's not going to cause the phones to go out. Now, the one thing that the GH's daughter kept kind of reminding everybody about or mentioning is the power plants.
Yeah.
And I think at that point, I think it was the night before, but they talked about a power plant being attacked. We saw that. I mean, we saw not power plant being attacked, but there were what there were in North Carolina. Wasn't there a relay station that was attacked?
That was like majorly impactful, like also.
Right.
Like
it, exactly. Now, I'm going to say this. It wasn't that impactful to a lot of ZERT members down there because they had generators and they were prepared. But imagine that. Look at that. Imagine that. But anyway, so at this point, people are. And I can't even say that Ethan Hawke's character activated his survival plan because they had these alerts and whatnot, because he was just like, I'm going to go out and get a newspaper. Like, I'm sorry, that's not part of my survival plan if the shit goes sideways, is to go get a newspaper.
Yeah. And so one of the things, like we talked about last week, I said that they were stuck in this mindset of, if we just give it 15 more minutes, everything is going to go back to normal. And we just, you know what, let's everybody lay down and take a nap and we'll wake up. Everything's going to be back to normal.
Right.
But I also noticed, I didn't zero in on it as much the first time I watched it, but rewatching it, I noticed that like Julia Roberts's mindset, that it's also a dangerous mindset, is she, in addition to that, she also has this, like, the grass is going to be greener somewhere else. Like, it's one of my favorite expressions in life is that you have to accept reality on reality's terms. Like, where you're at is where you're at. And like, I heard a new one yesterday. It's by some famous philosopher. I didn't take note of who the quote was attributed to, but how you feel about your life right now is how you feel about your life. Like, you can't get sucked into this. If I just do this next thing, if I just buy this next thing, if I just start going to the gym next week, if I just, and Julia Roberts like keeps doing that. Like, if we, you know what, we just need to go somewhere else. And the grass is not always going to be greener. Like, sometimes good enough is good enough. And if you have a good, safe place with some supplies and some manner of like physical security, and maybe you're not as far away from the city as you'd like to be, but for now, this is safe. Have you seen Generation Kill? The lieutenant talks about that in Generation Kill. He's that safety is relative. Like, we're in the middle of a combat zone and everybody else on Earth thinks that this is the most dangerous place on Earth. But right now I'm hiding behind this armored vehicle, so I'm safe. You know,
you bring up a couple of good points, and I want to talk about their geographic location in a minute here. But one of the things is that next day, I think before all of the people venture out, GH's character, because again, the daughter talks about a power plant, GH's character mentions the love bug virus.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was real. Mm-hmm. That was real back in 2000.
Yep.
And he's like, you know, they just found out it was just a couple of kids from the Philippines that were doing this, but it crippled businesses. We are a world connected, plugged in.
Yeah.
If you really start to peel back all the layers of this movie and what it was based on, it is a very, very scary thing. I am less worried about China and nukes than I am with what the ideology of this movie was about. Yep. I'm just going to say that. I am less worried about that. And we'll kind of tie that back together, because I think the last conversation that GH has in the movie is the most important thing to pay attention to.
Yeah, absolutely. And it goes back to, you know, the scariest thing about this whole situation, I think, is its authenticity. So, yeah.
Right. So a couple of things I noticed is, obviously, Ethan Hawke's character is driving to the store. He has no idea where he's at.
What's he wearing on his feet?
He's wearing sandals, like
fucking flip-flops, bro. We're 12 hours into the end of the world and you're still walking around in flip-flops.
Yeah, flip-flops, short, and a bowling shirt. Whatever. Oh, but, you know, and by the way, he did not bring any he didn't have a bat when he showed up. He grabbed some kind of makeshift weapon. And then when he decides to go out to the world that he is unsure of what's happening, does not bring anything with him except a pack of cigarettes. So there's no comms that are happening. He's driving around like a nincompoop. But I'm less concerned about his situation, because I think that just elaborates on his uselessness in the film, but more about GH's. So what I first noticed is he goes to the neighbors who he's pretty sure are not going to be home, but he goes there for a reason, which is to get the satellite phone. Got it. He now has his firearm. Great. He grabs his phone and he pulls it up to check his wife, because his wife at this point is in the air flying back from Morocco or something. The texts from the wife are prior to 11:15 p.m. The first one that you can read is at 9:23, and he is at the symphony because he's talking about, I wish you can hear this. And then there's obviously, and all of them are not delivered. Right. Okay. So he sees this, he realizes, in my mind, he realizes he can't do much about this right now. So he needs to just work on the problem that he can, which is acquiring the sat phone.
Have you ever used the sat phone? I wrote that down in my notes.
I have not. But before he gets to the sat phone is what I want to talk about.
Okay.
I'm sorry. At this point, the only thing that's happened is a blackout. We do not know what GH and his daughter saw driving to Long Island. But the next time he goes to another location, he pulls up to the house and it is littered with things.
Stuff. Yeah.
Stuff. Glass. The front door is open, not locked. He steps on the carpet. It is loaded with water.
Inexplicably.
Right. He calls out, nobody there. He moves through the house and he acquires a sat phone. Steps outside, tries to use a sat phone. Nada. No joy. Go ahead with the, have you tried? So
I was just, yes, I've.
That's a perfect setup.
That was like when I was in Afghanistan, that was one of the pieces of gear that I was responsible for carrying. Every time we went outside the wire, we had sat phones. And when I, like now I'm a hovercraft pilot. So anytime we do a mission that we consider over the horizon, we have to carry a sat phone as a tertiary means of communications. And so, yeah, I have quite a bit of experience with sat phones. And as a person that has quite a bit of experience with sat phones are still an enormous pain in the ass to use. Like they are not. They're not a satellite version of your cell phone. They are not user friendly. You have to have an access code to even like unlock the phone itself. Once you unlock the phone, you have to wait for it to establish communications with the satellite. Once it establishes communications, you have to put in the PIN number for your account, because if you don't have an account, like a billing account, if the cell phone or the satellite phone is fully functional and it has satellite connectivity and you're able to unlock it and it's charged, you still cannot use it if you don't have the PIN number for the billing account. And then once you have the PIN number for the billing account, you punch that in, then it will tell you have to dial. And then there's this whole like card. It's like a 3x5 card. And we, like, I always had it laminated because I was working around water, but because like it says it's this whole like spreadsheet basically in this little card of what region of the world are you in and what region of the world are you trying to call, because both of those things, and it's like if you're in the northern hemisphere western quadrant and you're trying to dial this one, you have to use this method of dialing, and it's a major pain in the ass. So the fact that the sat phone didn't work for this guy is, if you've ever used a satellite phone, I would bet even money that even if everything was working perfectly as it should, this guy would probably still not be able to use the sat phone. That's one of those Hollywood things. And I just thought I'd bring it up and throw it out there, because you know, using a satellite phone is not as easy as it
sure,
looks.
Sure. But I guess it raises a good question. Is a satellite phone something that an everyday person can acquire?
Yes.
And does it make sense to add it to your kit?
I would, based on my experience, I would say not.
Yeah. Okay. So there you go.
I would say that they're very expensive. The accounts are very expensive. And I think it's one of those things where like you get billed whether you use it or not. And sure. Then when you do use it, you get billed even more because probably, you yeah. used it. Yeah. And so it would like for the average person to buy a sat phone, get an account and add it to your go bag on the off chance that you might use this thing sometime in the future would be a very, very costly endeavor. I mean, if you're James Cameron, knock yourself out. But right. If you're right. James Franks, probably not.
So it lends itself to what's more effective and useful, ham radio license or a sat phone. Probably you're not really comparing apples to apples, but if you're talking in the realm of comms, when the yeah. when the cell phones go down, ham radio is going to be your better
100%, shot. 100%.
So one of the other things, the only thing to notice or to note about Ethan Hawke's segment here is, sure, he comes across the lady speaking in Spanish. We've identified what she says. She's just rambling that she's lost. And she's questioning what's going on. She references the drone dropping gas, which we find out is just a drone, I guess, dropping flyers. But the one thing that I want to note is that when he steps out of the car, confused and not knowing where he is, there's one brief communication that comes across talking about the cyber attack has affected animal migration. I don't understand the validity, or I don't understand why. I mean, maybe it was just to make the deer situation fit in all of this, but I don't know if that would have any real world.
Yeah, there's a couple of things that they do in the movie like that where you have to, and I guess that lends itself to the authenticity. Is this misinformation? Are they deliberately saying something that's false because so many people will go, oh, all right, well, I guess that explains the 100 deer that I saw in my backyard. Yeah. Or is there some truth to it? And not to go like too Terminator on you, but you know, I do think we have too quickly become too dependent on these electronic devices and so maybe there is something that I don't know about. There is some form of cyber attack that I'm not familiar with that could impact migratory patterns of animals. Yeah. I was just listening to, I believe, the Daily Wire's podcast a couple of days ago, and they're like now uncovering that China has successfully done cyber attacks over the last 2 or 3 years, but they've broken their cyber attacks have been focused on what's the word I'm looking for? Municipal utilities. And they've been successful in hacking into like these it said the cyber attacks were focused on gaining login credentials of workers at places like power stations and water treatment plants and stuff like that. And it's so that a hacker can log into these computer systems and it will look like it's a worker logging in. And so anyway, I think my point is there's ramifications to these things that are far beyond what I think the common person realizes. So that's either that radio broadcast was misinformation, like purposeful misinformation or disinformation, or number two, maybe cyber attacks are now that impactful in some way that even like a person like me doesn't even realize.
Got it. Okay. So at this point, GH, to me, the most impactful thing literally happens, which should change the entire trajectory of what happens next. He walks out after getting no joy on the sat phone. He walks into the back because he hears something and there's a bunch of birds flying around, notices the rest of the debris, but for whatever reason, the first thing that gets seen and focused on is the watch.
Yeah, I can't blame him for that.
Well, I mean, I get it, but he picked up the watch and fell right where he stood, and there was a dead body there. Like, right. How do you see the watch over the dead body? But that's for the movie effect, right? Because the movie needed to happen. That's why. So sees a watch in the sand, picks it up. It's attached to a severed arm, falls down, sees the pilot's dead body, then sees all of this debris behind the house.
Well, and like kind of like a trail of bodies also.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. There were more than one dead body. Like there was a lady still sitting in the chair. Mm-hmm. And the chair was upright on the beach. Sees the tail of the plane and the plane debris. So sees a plane destroyed, bodies everywhere, and then stands there for a second and then literally sees another plane falling out of the sky. He runs. It crashes. He runs into the back door of the house, and the water and sand come up over the dune and blow out the windows of the house. And I'm assuming that's how he got wet.
Right. And that's, that also explains like why everything was wet when he first got there, like inexplicably.
Right. Exactly. And just, I'm going to go back to the comment that the police officer made as they were leaving the beach. He said there was a report of these things running aground, and it had to do with their, something with their navigation system.
Yeah.
Okay. So the plane falling out of the sky, that's not really a navigation thing.
Right. That was one of the things that I found when I was looking up online articles. It was like, well, if the plane was manufactured before this date, it's part of this series, and that couldn't really happen. And so I don't know.
Right. So they don't really explain why the planes are falling out of the sky, but yeah. The plane falls out of the sky. If at this point your cell phone doesn't work, you can't get anybody on the internet, you check a sat phone, you have no satellite, and you're this guy who's gotten some information prior to all of this, and then two planes, one on the ground, another one at your feet, he goes back to the house. And his plan was just to sit there.
Yeah, that's one of the things I brought up last week about how, you know, each person goes off on their own little separate excursions and nobody is coming back and sharing information to try to paint a complete picture, which is, that's a big mistake.
Right. Now, he didn't want to share that information because he didn't want to upset his daughter.
Right.
But remember, his daughter is literally sitting there telling Julia Roberts, like, I think this is bigger than that. You know, so she's aware, she's in the know. So at this point he comes back and he explains the curve and he's talking about his line of work. And I don't think they ever really go into what his line of work is, but he talks about the curve, and how if you monitor the market, you can see these trends and it almost helps you see the future. I am sure that there is probably a little bit of validity to that.
Yep. I would say so.
I think that there is probably a bunch of people in the finance world that can see trends, watch the curve, see the spikes and the dips in the market and give you a snapshot of what's to come. I don't know. What do you think about that?
Yeah, no, I think you need to be a lot more intelligent on that subject than I am. But yeah, I think that's true. And he also references, you're right, it never really says what he does, but he also references at one point for one of his clients, part of his job was analyzing the cost benefit analysis of military operations, like kind of in terms of like this missile costed $1 million and we fired this cruise missile but only killed two guys, but you know, this little pill that we could drop in their water supply, this pill only costs 99 cents and we can kill the entire village. And so like kind of like cost benefit analysis like that, because that's when he breaks down that from like a financial standpoint, almost from a foreign power, you don't need to invest in aircraft carriers and F-35s and cruise missiles and atomic bombs. You can just create civil unrest, and that will do more damage than a nuclear weapon could do anyway. So he right. ties that into the cost benefit analysis of military operations. And like you said, people on the financial side can do trend analysis and kind of be predictive in that way as well.
Right. So, and this is part two, and part two ends with, I initially thought it was just this extremely high-pitched noise, but it wasn't at first. There were like rumblings, like mm-hmm. explosions happening. And I remember Julie Roberts' character freaking out, yep. and then this noise happens. This high-pitched noise, and everybody plugs their ears. Like, they just cover their ears. And then that's how, obviously, that's how the curve ends, and part three is the noise. And that's what it picks up where, you know, Julie Roberts heads out to the woods, and then I think it cuts to the kids out in the woods, because at this point, the two younger kids went to look for the deer. They ended up in that little shack out there. I don't know what the whole point of the story that that Archie told the little girl about the guy.
Yeah, it never there, ties into know, anything.
It never ties into anything, right? No. But after they walk back, that's when we see that the kid, Archie, is bit by some kind of bug. He pulls the bug off. He's looking for service to probably contact Taylor. Yeah. Or whatever, the girlfriend. So,
I wanted to tell you, I've watched this movie three times now, and I have this little part with the insect. I've not seen it. And when I watched it yesterday, I was specifically like going forward, going back, pausing.
Yeah,
I've not seen this because you mentioned it last week, and I said I missed it, and I deliberately looked for it and still couldn't.
I'm terrible. And he actually references it at the end of the movie, but. It's right when they're walking out, it's a low camera shot and they're looking at just ankles, and she's in front and then he is, and then he reaches down and he slaps his ankle and he pulls something off, and she's looking at the city, because she sees the flock of birds, and then obviously the noise happens. But
at this point, I wrote down, I wanted to make a point of this. At this point where we're talking about right now, where we hear the noise for the first time, this is roughly based on the clues that we're given and the timestamps, this is roughly 12 hours into this whole situation. Like, it's roughly 24 hours since the tanker thing, but since we, meaning the viewer and the family, right. has learned that that the tanker was not an isolated incident. And since we first heard of the blackout and all this stuff, that it's only been 12 hours. Like, all this stuff has happened in 12 hours. And I only bring that up because it is important, because like, things happen fast and things move fast. Like, and
right.
time is not necessarily a luxury that you have. And so that's why I wanted to bring up that at this point, we're really only roughly 12 hours into this bad situation that's unfolding.
Yeah. So at this point, they are, everyone's back at the house. Archie comes back to the house. They're sitting there. Clay comes back to the house, and Archie actually says his head feels weird. After saying, so this is after the sound, he's like, my head feels weird. And he says, I should have covered my ears sooner. My head feels really weird. Mm-hmm. And the GH's daughter says something about it. And then they kind of, they move on. That's when Clay comes back. He's freaking out, about the drone thing, dropping the paperwork or the papers. And at this point is what you just referred to earlier, is when the family decides to leave. And that's when GH is like, and she's like, yeah, we're going to be better in New Jersey. GH is like, you have to drive through the city to get through New Jersey. Like, you're making a bad choice here.
Right.
They do it anyway. The daughter notices the sirens. And then nobody talks about those sirens again. When we have a siren in the town that I grew up in, and it used to go off every day at noon, they would test the siren. I mean, you knew to hear it at noon, but if it was not noon and you were hearing that, there's probably a reason. This girl, she was like, no, I can't nap because of the sirens. And they just completely gloss over that. Okay.
Okay.
After everything that just happened, we're not going to just kind of peel that back a little bit to be like, well, what do you mean the sirens? Stop the car, open the window. And then you get to this convoy of white Teslas that are destroyed and you still do nothing. You just, I'm going to go look at it. I was just like, okay, obviously, you know, what happened there were all of these self-driving capable vehicles were used as a blockade to block off Long Island from people leaving Long Island. They don't really explain why. They don't really go into what the purpose of that would be. But as they pull that shot out, they show you that there is, yeah, exactly, sideways. And then there is a bunch of other cars on another highway. And they've basically...
This is one of those great spots to pause it, because there is a lot to unpack. And if you don't pause it, it's that shot is probably less than one Mississippi. I mean, it's probably less than a second. Right. If you catch it and pause it, there is a lot of good stuff in that little image. And it's almost like a drone shot pulling back, but it turns sideways. And so you have to pause the TV and then turn your head sideways to look at it. But there's a lot going on in that little image. But yeah.
Right. So and you know, we're over the hour mark here, and there's still so much to talk about, but what I want to kind of do is, as we wrap this up, what happens the rest of it is obviously the family comes back, and then, you break off into two different groups of things happening. The husband and the daughter are out sitting by a fire, smoking pot, you know, just having kind of everyday conversation-ish, then to a little bit more and about the situation, which gets interrupted by a bunch of flamingos landing in a pool in Long Island. Julie Roberts' character and GH, and I keep saying GH because I don't know how to pronounce that dude's name, but they go and they have a conversation that turns sideways, and then they go to move past that by putting on music and dancing, and then engage in an embrace that questions their marriage and loyalty to their spouse. So it is what it is at that point. There is a little scene between the young daughter and the brother where the brother's in bed coughing. So he's coughing. He wakes up coughing. She's asking about friends. He's like, yeah, worry about something else. I believe at
and
some
he was,
point.
Sorry, he was jerking the gherkin too, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. That was another thing. Yeah, where that's he was kind of, looking at was pictures a, of. Right.
Yeah.
So, and then at some point, addition. Yeah, after that dancing, after the flamingos, the noise happens again, which is what drives the family of four to sleep in one bed and the other family to continue to sleep in the basement. During the family of four's going to sleep situation, Archie, the son, is asleep, and the wife recognizes that he is hot or warm. The father is asleep, and the young daughter is sitting there telling the story about the flood. And, you know, it is what it is. All right. So the next day, wakes up. Oh, God. The ding. Time's up. The teeth falling out situation. And this is where they're sitting on the couch after Archie pulls out his teeth. And he says, I got bit by a bug. And if you remember, GH's character says, oh, well, that could be what it is. Tick, Lyme disease. Now, that's not the case at all. And where I want to kind of wrap this up is the two husbands and the son go to get help while the two women go to try and find the younger daughter. They go to Kevin Bacon's character's house where he is a prepared individual. You can tell he's got rain collection. He's got solar. He's got cameras. He does everything right when they knock on the door. He looks through the window with a shotgun. They do show you a daughter upstairs, so you know that he is a father. He is protecting somebody, we assume, and it's not somebody that he's kidnapped. But he looks through the window, communicates through the window, tells them to get off his porch, steps out with a shotgun, creates some distance, and then the conversation happens. And he's like, yeah, we're not friends. You're thinking the old way here. Yeah. Things are changed. And there's a lot that happens there, right? I mean, there's a lot of animosity. There's a lot of people questioning, or there's a lot of things being questioned, being talked about. At the end of the day, and you brought it up last week, where Ethan Hawke's character steps in front of the two of them, drawing down on each other, and he basically says, I'm a useless man without my GPS and blah, blah, blah. And they end up trading cash for medicine. And what's funny is Ethan Hawke's character was like, I have cash. And the guy's like, well, cash isn't going to be worth anything. And he's like, well, there's no Venmo. There's no Apple Pay. And he kind of realizes that, well, maybe cash is worth something. Money in that situation, it may not be good in digital or hard currency. Who knows? Anyway, it's de-escalated. He takes the $1,000, gets some blue pills. Could be Viagra, could be penicillin. They don't really tell you.
Now, I think they're. I think those are actually. I should know this, being in the military, but there's pills that you can take for radiation sickness, and I think that's what he gave him. Okay. And also, like, to me, they didn't make it. If they were trying to make this inference, they didn't make it obvious enough. But like, to me, like, you see the kid has like really dark like bags under his eyes at this point. And to me, his face also looked like it was like sunburned, like radiation burn. But they didn't make it obvious enough that I'm sure about that one.
Right.
But I think the pills they gave him were for radiation sickness treatment.
Okay. And
I forget what they're called.
Right. And they talk about that. Kevin Bacon's character talks about that. The only thing that doesn't compute there is they all experience the same thing. And if you watch it, everyone went like this and immediately covered it. And he maybe didn't cover his ears for 5 seconds.
Yeah.
But he covered his ears. So what happens next is Kevin Bacon's character says something. Then they get back in the car, and GH comes to a realization based on everything that has happened and that he knows up until this point. And I think it is the most important part of the film for me. I actually recorded it. And I was going to recite it, but I'm just going to summarize it. But basically, this is when he talks about that client, and he talks about one model that was it the government or the military, but he talks about a model to basically decivilize a country.
It's a three-tiered model.
Model to decivilize any country. And it starts within, and it starts with communication.
Well, he calls it isolation.
Isolation.
And right. And the way to isolate is to cut off communications.
Cut off movement. Communication. Right. And movement. The second part is to basically create chaos.
Yeah.
Confusion, chaos. And they flash back to the scene where they're, on the ground and the noise is happening. And then the third is what he calls the coup de grace. And it's basically civil war. And it was proven to just completely destroy a country from within without anybody else doing it. And I think that's what he basically says, is the next part is they leave it up to us.
Yeah, we all turn on each other, basically.
We all turn on each other.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas, everybody. But I mean, what's a little bit unnerving to that is we saw a glimpse of that. We saw a glimpse of that 3 years ago.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
You're seeing a little bit of a glimpse of that right now with what's happening in Israel and you know, with Hamas and how that's spilling over to here. I mean, that's a little bit freaky right there, you know?
Well, yeah, because the key to unrest and chaos is you've already got isolation, then you've got fear, then you have to have division, and then the divided sides turn in on each other, and then you have right. like complete collapse, and that's at least that part, we're already there. This country is already extremely polarized and divided.
Right. So that's where it's when I said before, the threat of a nuclear attack from China is less concerning to me than this situation. Imagine tomorrow Facebook goes down. Oh my God, the people are going to lose their mind. And then the next day, oh, no more Instagram. Oh, and no more Twitter. Right. You know, and what's horrible about that is for us, for our ZERT members, I mean, we communicate through that. There's a lot of information that gets passed along there. We go back to why ham radio is important. But folks, I want everybody, if you haven't watched that movie by now, you've heard enough about it through these two shows, to go and watch it and just think about that. Now, all of this could be fake and a dream. That entire movie could be a dream. And where I'm going to go with that is exactly what I texted you about last night and what I said we were going to circle back around to. So when the cinematography on this movie is awesome. And when Julia Roberts is walking around this house, it's just beautiful architecture. And she goes up and the first thing you see is in this living room, and you see this giant wall print. And I would say that it's probably, I don't know, 8 feet by 10 feet on this wall. And it's black and white. Yeah. Big tapestry, black and white.
Modern abstract is what I would call it.
There you go. Yep. Then she goes up into the bedroom, and again, beautiful bedroom, minimalistic, with just a bed and like end tables, and the entire accent wall behind the bed is a ocean scene, a calm ocean.
Just the surface of
just
the ocean.
Just the surface of the ocean. That's in part one of the house. Part two, which is after the knock on the door, the tanker going sideways, the comms being down, you wake up the next day and the opening shot is is Ethan Hawke and Julia Roberts' character in bed. And as they pull back, the ocean scene is now changed. Mm-hmm. It's a rough ocean.
Rougher.
Rougher ocean, correct. You go downstairs.
It's rougher.
Right. You go downstairs, and the first scene, again, is a pulled back shot of Ethan Hawke's character standing in front of the TV, and you look at the tapestry, and that has changed. It is no longer what it was.
After you brought that to my attention, in the movie, there's part one, part two, part three, part four. The surface of the ocean accent wall, it only changes, like, it's in part one, it's one way, part two, part three, part four, the image of the surface of the ocean gets progressively worse, and the waves get bigger and bigger and bigger. So that's progressive, and you know, and logical and ties into the plot, that the thing in the living room, the best that I could tell, I stopped counting because I eventually just realized that every time they show it, it's different. So it didn't change. It's not like one thing in part one and one thing in part two. It's every single time they show it, it's different. And that's the part where, like, I guess I'm not smart enough to understand what to make of that, other than you're just supposed to know that it keeps changing because it doesn't.
Okay. So
it's not really an image of anything.
Right. So two things I'll tie it here to, and then, you know, and then we can leave the viewers with some thought provoking questions here or thought provoking ideas. I only noticed it change three times, which at some point
changed way more than that.
Okay. So I noticed it only three times, but I guess it changed more. So could this entire thing be a dream sequence? Maybe. It could be. What I noticed, that it was a black and white, which I'm curious to hear what other people saw, but it's like a Rorschach, right? I mean, when you look at a Rorschach, it's just images, ink blots, and you decipher what it is, and there's changing. There will probably be some after show research on Rorschachs and what that all means, and who knows if that is connected to it. But folks, it could all just be a dream. But who knows? There are a lot of things that I took away from this film. It was definitely a great film. I've definitely recommended it to other people. If you don't want to watch it because two of the executive producers are people you may not like, great. I mean, it is what it is. It was well done. There's a lot you can take away that, and you can store for later on it. What I find interesting is they leave it with the coup de grace, Civil War, right?
Or not. Or
not.
Some type of war. Yeah.
Some type of war. And then what I find hilarious is there is a movie coming out in 2024 called Civil War. And it's exactly what they alluded to in this movie.
Yeah.
The state of Texas and California create basically their own civilization here or whatever. And that's what it's all about, which is weird. Texas and California, does not make sense, maybe just size wise, but at the end of the day, I'm curious to see what that movie is all about. But yeah, guys, that's our take, or that's my take on this.
Yep.
I enjoyed watching it. I enjoyed talking about it. I enjoyed taking some pieces away as a survivalist and figuring out that comms in general, internet and phone down, and then a couple other things weird happen. We're calling an audible on our weekend away at the Hamptons.
And the first three letters of prepping or preparation is PRE, pre. So like, you got to front load some stuff. You got to, you know, we, like you said, we communicate via Facebook and Instagram and stuff because it's convenient, because we can, because it's very accessible. But to go and get a ham radio and a ham license and construct some, you know, an antenna, that takes a little bit of, you got to burn some calories to do that stuff. But you need to do it ahead of time. You got to do it before you need it. You got to buy ammo before you need it. You got to buy a gun before you need a gun. So, you know, a couple of the other takeaways are things that we've talked about. There are things that you can use your cell phone for when there is no service, when there is no connectivity. There's a feature of Google Maps that I think most people don't know about, where you can download the map sets to your phone and it's stored on your phone locally. So you don't have to have internet access or Wi-Fi to access the maps. You can't use GPS. Also, your phone doesn't actually have a GPS receiver. When you pull up Google Maps, for example, and it shows you where you are, that's a visual representation of your bearing and range from the nearest cell phone tower. Now, I know enough about it to know that your phone doesn't actually have GPS. People just call it that because that's a common use term that people understand. Global positioning system. It is what you think is GPS on your phone is showing you where you are, but it's not actually using satellite triangulation, which is right. Truly what GPS is. Your phone doesn't actually have a GPS antenna on it.
Yeah.
But I don't know enough to know that if the communication network is down, will that function still work? I don't know the answer to that. I would kind of think not, but it would still be a useful thing to preload maps, you know, hard download map sets to your phone. You can use them when the phone's offline. We talked about the bug out vehicle episode. One of your best bug out vehicle options is like a dirt bike. And when they do that big pulled back shot and they show all the gridlock on the freeways and stuff, well, if you had a dirt bike, you could go right through it, there. You know? So yeah. There's lots of stuff that we've already covered, yeah. Is valid here. And
exactly.
You know, the right. painting that keeps changing in the living room, like the reason I know that it changed so many times, cause it was a Rorschach. And so like the first time they showed it, it looked like big boobs to me. And then the second time they showed it, I saw small boobs. And then the third time it was medium sized boobs. And then the next time it was fake boobs. And so, you take what you want from that Rorschach, but yeah, lots of good stuff to unpack. I think the dream sequence thing, I think is a little bit too easy. Like I'm a huge Sopranos fan. And some people have tried to claim that after the Sopranos finale, that the entire series,
no,
well, was a dream sequence, right. And that, but that's.
I mean, yeah, you know, whether it was just for visual representation or whether they wanted the people to catch it, it is what it is. One of the things that I would recommend to everybody, because you never know when you're going to lose connectivity, GPS or whatnot, and it could have changed the course of a lot of things, is if Clay, Ethan Hawke's character, had an Atlas in his vehicle
100.
When he left to go get a newspaper, a lot of information could have been acquired and things could have different decisions could have been made at that point. Granted, everything went sideways after that, but remember, he went one way, he turned around, he went the other way, he turned around, he went back the other way, which, if you think about it, if you're going in a straight and they show you, and he's not driving for that long, but again, pick up an Atlas, get a yeah. little analog in your life. Okay.
Cheap insurance.
Exactly. All right, guys. Well, listen, we appreciate you spending another 90 minutes with us here. The ZERT Coffee and Chaos podcast is one of my favorite things. We are wrapping the year up here at ZERT with HQ. We have some exciting things happening next year. There's even more exciting things that are happening that I can't get into too much, but keep an eye out on the social media pages. The XP001 remastered figure is up for pre-order on Black Ops Toys. If you have not done that and you're interested and you missed the first one, get out there, pick that up, because the first 300 when they sell out will activate a new line of those things, and you never know who will get a character. So until next time, folks, you stay safe, don't be a resupply. Jamie.
Hey, by the next time we record an episode, Santa will have come and left me a lump of coal, and so maybe we can unpack that in the next episode. But until then, have a Merry Christmas, and it's easy to be hard and it's hard to be smart.
All right, Merry Christmas, y'all. See ya.